like, oh,
you have to work
on
it.
No, no,
no. I do.
Sure.
Over you. What were you actually seeing at the time?
I was seeing a
Monster on it. That's what I was saying.
But in a lot of the shots, you and the other actors are reacting to things off screen that make the drama not have been there. So you're reacting, it's called acting, I guess, you're reacting.
We were reacting, yes, to pictures of the beasts. Yes, I had a very good art department at 20th Century Fox. Yes.
Did you meet Bernard Herrmann at all?
Yes, he came on the set a couple of times. He was really fond of him.
Isn't that a great score for that year?
Oh, yes. He's a very polished man. And even though he had worked many, many films with Hitchcock, I think this was the first Jules Verne film that he had done. And he loved Jules Verne. He just absolutely loved it. That's why he came on the set, not in Fox, but Cameron, but at 20th Century Fox, so that he could really get the impression and the feeling of what we were doing.
So he was watching you as he was composing.
Yes.
And that's why the score.
Hopefully, we inspired him.
Obviously, because the score matches the action.
Yes. So he was a genius. He really was a genius. A musical genius.
I think that. Albums of this score. I mean,
yes, I think there are. I don't have one, but maybe eBay has some.
It should be put out for the 50th anniversary. It really has a kind of symphonic
structure. It does. Really?
Now, Leo Tolbert, who's your cinematographer, I want to mention,
yes,
also shot on my other favorite sci-fi film, at least, David Bristol's film.
Oh, yes.
And Bernard Herrmann did the score for that as well. Now, Leo Tolbert started shooting movies in the silent era.
Did he?
So he went and was back to about 1925.
He never went back that far,
though. He was a wonderful cinematographer.
Yes, he was.
He was.
The art direction was fantastic. He was brilliant. And, of course, being on location was very beautiful, beauty treatments around. The lighting was fantastic. He makes sure that I look well on the screen. And there were a couple of nights I had sleepless nights, but he covered it up really well.
Now, sometimes your hair is a little too in place for the reality.
Well, I think they wanted me to keep it braided in the back, you know, so that I wouldn't have to worry about it. But, yes, well,
now you're playing a Swedish character.
Yes.
You are Norwegian descent.
Yes.
Were you using a Swedish accent in particular?
Well, I was using a Scandinavian accent. Yes. And of course the tall accent, Hans, is from Iceland. And you know in Iceland they speak Old Norse. So I have learned Old Norse. Norwegian is a part of Old Norse. So when he spoke to me in Old Norse, I answered him in Old Norse.
And that is you speaking?
I learned how to speak very early in my childhood. My grandfather, who always spoke Norwegian to me, lived with us. So my first language was really Norwegian.
So you're going to work for
me? I was. Not speaking it for a long time, losing vocabulary, but I know how to say, yeah, fox and egg and mother pop.
Was there a dialect called Translang?
No, I had my own dialect.
Had your own dialect.
Yes. But there's something very strange that happened. Zanuck was the head of the studio at 20th Century Fox at the time. And he saw the Russians, which were sent back to him every day from Mexico. And he said, we have all these languages. Who speaks English in this film? We have to get rid of some of those accents. Papert spent 6 weeks or 8 weeks learning how to speak Scottish with a Scottish word. And of course, Jay spoke with an English accent. And I was talking up and down and up and down like that. And of course, Hans was Icelandic. He spoke no English. So Zendik had us come back to the studio after 3 months of